In this week's episode, we talk about nothing and interview Justin Wirth of Diesel Boy and Black Poison Viper and The Disciples and Fang.
Welcome in once again to Punk Rock Foodies Radio, coming at you live from downtown Mattersville at the Vicious Pig Saloon. This is your one-stop shop for everything punk rock and food. And now, your hosts, Steve Guerrero, Skate Rat Betty, Brian Reinhardt, and the asshole in charge, Xander T.
And that was NoFX with The Bag, and you are listening to Punk Rock Foodies Radio. I am the asshole in charge of Punk Rock Foodies, Xander T.
NoFX? We never play NoFX on
the
show.
We never play NoFX, I know. That's why I was like, what band do we rarely ever play?
Never gets played. It's amazing. NoFX, never heard of them.
They've been around for a couple of years.
Yeah.
But with me at the Vicious Pig Saloon today is...
Steve Guerrero. And I'll play some more NoFX for you guys later.
And Brian Reinhardt, and I'm probably going to play some Body Count.
Yeah!
Nice.
And we are skate ratless yet again, but we're definitely getting her work back into the rotation for everybody that desires her voice.
She still posts daily, her and Mike, so they're still contributing.
Yes. Absolutely. But as you know, as it usually goes, whenever she's not here, we really have nothing to talk about.
Yes.
So that's what we will be doing. But first a little information, because somehow you found this podcast and didn't realize that Punk Rock Foodies is a Facebook group, and you can join. All you have to do is
Facebook is a web page. It's a website
that you can sign up for.
It's pretty new.
Yeah. You just need an email address, really, to do it, and you should look into it. And then come over to Punk Rock Foodies. You make food, you take a picture of the food, you post that picture of food. It's that simple. That's all. That's all it is. Food.
We hope to expand to MySpace pretty soon, but for now it's just Facebook.
And Friendster.
And Friendster.
Friendster, yes. Yeah, so come check us out, and we like food, we like punk rock. So we're going to listen to some punk rock and then talk about nothing. So who would like to play a song for us?
Go for it, Steve.
All right, well, how about some old school Offspring? I've been listening to the CD a lot lately. It's a good summertime CD for me, Ignition.
CD?
This is...
You don't have it on 8-track?
Hypodermic.
I remember
having this when I was, 17 or whatever, and Hypodermic was the first song on side two, and I'd get so excited, switch over from Dirty Magic to Hypodermic, because that song just fucking kicks
Dirty
ass.
Dirty Magic, I love those songs. Yeah, dude, I had the cassette.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, dude, I still have an Offspring shirt from that era. It's my oldest shirt in my closet, and it's amazing.
And you've never washed it.
I try not to wash it too much, try not to wear it too often, because I want it sticking around for another 20 years. But, yeah, I said, you listen to Punk Rock Food Radio. This is The Offspring with Hypodermic.
Talk shit! motherfucker ain't got shot in a while. Niggas ain't blew up the spot in a while. Motherfucker ain't got shot. Don't push, motherfucker, I push back. Fuck with me and catch a 223. We in the age and the gauge, double lots to make the talk stop. Black ops, I fucking live for the headshot. Act hard, motherfucker, stick your chest out. Break through a bitch, that would be your best route. Don't test me, I'm a psycho with the rifle. Beast with the peace, bully with the fully. Anyone can get it. Anyone can get it.
Watch your head, church. Pray to the God.
Anyone can get it.
Just coming back safe. Try to get an autograph.
Anyone can get it. For some reason, you motherfuckers think this is a game. You think you can say anything you want and nothing will ever happen to you. You think we live in a new age. But let me tell you, it can happen real easy. Don't make me bring the gravity, nigga. You can get hit with the fifth, twisted with the biscuit, blasted with the ratchet, jack with the Mac, body with the shoddy, dump with the pump, rock with the clock, sprayed with the K, dome with the chrome, down with the pound, tap with the strap, whack with the gat, dusted with the musket, tag with the mag, wet with the Intratec, bled with the lead. Talk shit. Shot! Act hard, motherfucker! Get shot! Pop off! Get shot!
Okay, that changed it up a little bit. That was a band called Body Count with Mr. Ice-T. I'm in a silly mood. It's a song called Talk Shit, Get Shot. And for those who don't know, that's off their newest album. And if you go on YouTube and YouTube the song Talk Shit, Get Shot, it's just a video of Ice-T and all the other guys in the band driving around shooting people. And it's just, like, it's literally them pulling, the Body Count pulling up in a van next to, like, a cafe where these old white ladies are eating lunch and just shooting them with AKs and blood shoots everywhere. It's the silliest, dumbest, it's like Dave Chappelle when Wayne Brady pulls up and shoots that guy.
Yeah.
That's basically the video for Talk Shit, Get Shot. So go check it out. It's funny.
Did Burning Rose Studios produce
no,
that?
No, I wish they would have. I would have been fine.
It would be a lot better production value if it was Burning Rose. So yeah, it is the simplest, like the it's a metal riff, quote unquote. But anyone I know who could play it on guitar, it is the simplest little thing. So, but anyway, and we're back on Punk Rock Foodies Radio. I'm Brian. I'm here with Steven, the asshole in charge, Xander, and. We're not really. We're just going to kind of make this shit up as we go today because we are skate rat-less and mic-less today.
We're going to talk shit. Hopefully, we don't get shot.
Don't get shot.
We'll take a couple shots.
But, yeah. Actually, drinking coffee. It's been a while. I forgot. This stuff's pretty good.
Yeah, you know, I got into coffee this past week. I started drinking it. Like, I don't. I usually like maybe like once, like on like Sunday. Like, I'll have a cup. But, like, this whole past week, I was, like, every morning I was
having
a cup of coffee.
You're a teacher. How do you not drink coffee? How do you get up in the mornings, dude?
I definitely drink caffeine, but I'm just not a coffee fan. Like, I'll do, like, green tea or, like, Pepsi Max or Dr. Pepper or some shit.
I generally don't like hot drinks. For years, I didn't like coffee until recently, but got a little Keurig, and that just kind of changed the game for me.
You know, my mom, when my parents come to visit, my mom brings her own, like, percolator coffee pot because she refuses to use the Keurig for some reason. And so finally I asked her, and the reasoning was that it doesn't get hot enough, so it cools faster.
Like, yeah, it's not scalding hot like it would be otherwise. Yeah. That's true.
But, like, I just want to drink it. Like, I'm not going to, like, I'm not waiting around to spend all day drinking a fucking cup of coffee.
I want it to cool off faster. I don't want it super hot.
Yeah. Absolutely. It burns your fucking mouth. You can't taste anything for a week.
Yeah, and I'm a delicate flower, so.
That you are, bro.
I just want that caffeine. I like, I'm a big iced coffee guy. Fuck that. Just give me the caffeine, bro.
Now, see, I can't drink. I don't like iced coffee. I don't like it cold. Like, when it gets cold, forget it. It's got, there's, like, this range. Not too hot, not too cold, you know? I don't know. I'm just weird like that.
I'm old school, man. I do Mountain Dew if I need a caffeine fix in the morning. Straight up Mountain Dew. Yeah. Give me that green stuff.
Yeah. college, that's what I used to drink. Mountain Dew or Dr. Pepper. Those were the
Mountain Dew doesn't have much effect on me anymore, to be honest. I got to drink a lot of it. You know what I mean? I might as well. I mean, it's just like, there's so much sugar, and I'm not one of those people that thinks, like, sugar, oh, sugar's bad for you, but there is a certain level. You know,
yeah.
If you look at a bottle of Mountain Dew, like, if you just, like, dried it out, like, a quarter of that would just be raw sugar. So, but yeah. I still drink Mountain Dew. I still do. I had a lot of years of use of Mountain Dew, but
I do the Dew.
I'm just not as extreme as I used to be, you know? I'm not exact. I don't go wakeboarding and bungee jumping as much anymore, you know, bro? You know? Once I get past the age of 35, bro, it's just, I can't be extreme anymore.
Yeah, I hear you, man.
Yeah, tone down the extremities.
Extremities? I like extremities better.
Yeah.
Now I get extreme with the video games, man. Let's get extreme with Diablo 3 on the Xbox One. Yeah.
I'm going to play standing up.
That's what we do.
I think it's going to be time here to start firing up my old PlayStation or something, because I haven't played it in years. And I took Gunner to the arcade last week, and there's this, like, ATV driving game that he freaking loves, but he can't reach the pedal at all. So I just got to stand there and kind of keep my foot on the gas the whole time. But, dude, every time he's driving, he's like, this is so awesome!
There's a million games like that for the PlayStation, man. So
I know. Yeah. I need to step my game. I have to pick your brain and see what games are good. But it's been a while since I was a gamer.
Which video game, which one is it? Which PlayStation do you have? The regular? One, PS4? Two, three?
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Okay, so you got the new one. You made it sound like you had the original PlayStation.
Yeah.
No, no. It might be PS3. I don't know. I'd have to look at it. It's been a while.
Well, as far as PlayStation, if you got a kid that likes racing, just find any of the old Crash Bandicoot games.
Ooh, cool.
He'll love them. He'll love them.
I was always into the, like, Madden, the football games.
Yeah,
that was
me,
like,
too.
That's all I ever really played. I had a bunch of other shit, but I don't know.
The last sports game that I really played on a regular basis, and I wish they'd bring it back, was NHL Hits. I don't know if anyone ever played NHL Hits. It was just the most exaggerated, like, NHL game. It was just 3-on-3, and it was just it wasn't really about scoring. It was just how big of a hit you could lay on the other guy. It was just like, they might as well just call it head injury.
I thought you were going to say Blades of Steel.
Blades of Steel, that was great.
The original ice hockey for NES, man, with the fights.
And you went to the penalty box if you lost the fight.
Yeah. Oh, there was a lot riding on those fights, man, because if you lost, it's like, oh, well, you suck, you're going to the penalty box.
Isn't that the game that they're playing on Swingers, too, where he makes his head bleed? He's like, look, your head's bleeding, Mikey, your head's bleeding.
No, that's just regular
NHL.
That's for Genesis.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that was just the NHL. What was a basketball game? There was a basketball game that was like
Arch Rivals.
No. Well, not double dribble. Was it Arch Rivals, or was it like 2-on-2 and it was like just extreme slam dunks and like
NBA Jam.
Maybe that was
NBA Jam. That was the one. He's on fire.
We went to Europe like 8 years ago, 9 years ago. My buddy has like the old school Nintendo, and all his friends play that game. I whipped everybody's monkey ass in that all night long, dude. It was amazing. I only lost one time, and it's because I didn't get a shot off at the buzzer to win it. And I was fucking around, you know. That's the only time
that game dominated, man. That was the best, because you had like even the crappy teams. You know, like back then when it came out, like the Mavericks, it was still like Jason Kidd and Jamal Mashburn and
the Bulls were Parks.
Yes, and the Bulls were always like Scottie Pippen and Dennis Rodman because you couldn't get Jordan. Like Jordan was never in any of the games, so the Bulls were the best team, but they weren't as good because you couldn't get fucking Jordan in there.
You could have Kukoc and Pippen, but you couldn't have Jordan.
that's me. Yeah, or like Bill Wennington. There was a video on YouTube about a year ago when Kobe was retiring. Steve, I know you saw it as a Laker fan, where it was just like highlights of Kobe like missing shots, and it was like, he's not heating up, and it was the old oh, he missed another shot. This is just like, you know, they'd lose by four and he would take 70 shots.
Yeah.
That was the game we played during the the Oilers-Bills playoff game at halftime, when the Oilers were killing them like 35-7. We turned off the game and started playing that game, and then turned it off, and all of a sudden it's like the Bills are winning. Like, what the hell?
Yeah. I still remember where I was during that game. I was getting my oil changed. I was sitting there in the waiting room like, holy shit. And then they just kept scoring and scoring. I'm like, holy shit. I'll never forget it.
Frank Reich.
And then, of course, the Bills went on to win the championship that year. Wah, wah, wah.
No, but they got it the next year. No, yeah. No.
Yeah.
That was but the next year they did.
The year after that.
No. Which,
do you go wide left, wide right, wide left? I forget. It's been a long time.
Yeah. They actually did a really good 30 for 30.
It was
30
very
30
good.
Whatever.
It was very good. I was going to mention that. It was really good. It really makes you feel bad for... Makes you remember how good those teams were.
Oh, yeah.
Like, if you were in the AFC for about a six-year span, you didn't have a fucking prayer because the Bills just whooped your ass.
Yeah,
But then they'd run into the Cowboys every year, and they should have beat the Giants that first year, but they missed that field goal. You know, but after that, it was just Cowboys, 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 and nobody was going to beat the Cowboys.
Well, they played the Redskins 1 year.
Yes. Yeah. So, but yeah, they just I remember every year the Dolphins were like, we're going to get them this year, and then they would fucking get their asses kicked by the Bills.
Nope.
Yeah. Nope, nope, nope.
I'm ready for NFL season to start back up. It's going to be a good year this year.
I'm not ready at all. I am, like, not ready at all. Maybe it's because I don't want to go back to work.
Dude, I cannot wait for the Bears to win 4 or 5 games. I can't wait. It's going to be great. It's going to be awesome.
If the Raiders are 800 or 500 team this year, I'll be a happy guy. But they can finish 9-7. I mean, they can pull it off, but we'll see.
My mom was bitching about the fact that the Steelers play on Christmas Day and New Year's Day. I said, Mom, because that's because they're Sundays. Everybody does.
Yeah. and those are the teams that everybody wants to see. You know what I mean? Yeah. They're going to get. Are they on like the teams like aside from the Lions? The teams that they want to see play are going to be on Thanksgiving.
And that's what I point out to her. It's like, you know, the team, they put those games. She bitches every year because the Steeler games end up being like a 4 o'clock game instead of a 1 o'clock game. They're a Thursday night game, a Monday, a Sunday night game, and she gets
prime time.
Bitching. It's like because people want to watch the Steelers play, no matter where you live in the country. You know,
they're a popular team.
Yeah. So sorry.
Nobody's lining up to see the Jaguars. Yeah. Sorry, all our Jacksonville listeners out there. Sorry, guys, but.
They still have a team in Jacksonville? Weren't they getting rid of it?
Kinda. Yeah.
And there's football now, back in Los Angeles.
I was
That's
just
going
to say that, Steve. Yeah. You're LA Rams now.
Yeah, I had a couple friends go to game last this past weekend for the preseason game. So
yeah,
it's alive and well.
That's awesome.
Been watching the Hard Knocks. There's the one guy on the team, I forget who he is, but he thinks dinosaurs are fake. Have you been watching Hard Knocks on HBO?
No.
There's a guy on the Rams, some, I don't know, he's a wide receiver, a DB or something like that. He thinks that dinosaurs are fake and scientists plant them to fool people. So, like, all his teammates are, like, putting dinosaurs, like little toy dinosaurs, in his locker to fuck with him. But here's the kicker. He thinks mermaids are real. So he, therefore, I'm telling you, man, you got to watch Hard Knocks. I think it's the second episode. So when they moved from St. Louis to L.A., he was all excited because he was going to be near the coast, and he thinks his chances of seeing a mermaid have increased exponentially.
Well, they dinosaurs have.
Dinosaurs are fake, but mermaids are real. Like, he literally, like, this is not an exaggeration. He really thinks mermaids, like, he feels it with all his heart. So it's worth checking out, this guy.
just when you thought football players were dumb. Yeah. This guy shows up.
What do you expect from a guy who gets paid to run head first into other people?
Pretty much, right?
Yeah. Wow. Is he a flat earther, too?
He probably is.
Wow.
Big on chemtrails.
Yeah. No, I will say, though, but the one thing, you know, football season, like this whole preseason, I haven't watched the thing. I don't know what's going on. My dad was telling me that two of the backup quarterbacks for the Steelers are hurt. I'm like, I don't even know who they are. Like, I just, like, once the season starts, fine. But I really am looking forward to the fact that then that's like a Sunday afternoon.
Backup quarterbacks in the league do not matter, because I don't care who you are. I don't care how good a team you are. If your starting quarterback goes down, that's the end of your season. I don't give a shit who you are. There are no good backups in the entire league. Don't lose your starter. I don't care who it is.
Well, okay, remember years ago when Tom Brady got knocked out in like the first quarter of the first game, and then Matt Castle?
Chiefs. Only time I liked the Chiefs.
Matt Castle took over, and I mean, they made the playoffs. They didn't go to the Super Bowl that year, but I mean, they had still a decent...
They didn't make the playoffs. They won 11 games, though. But, yeah, you're right. That one time that happened. Yeah. But it's not like it... That's not the norm.
And then they got rid... And then Castle got picked up somewhere else to be a starter, you know?
Yeah, they gave him a ton of money. And it sucked.
KC, he went to KC and was
horrible. I think he ended up going to KC,
He did,
Yeah, and he was in a... He was in, like, a British Knights commercial with Danny... what's his face from Eastbound and Down? No, the mullet dude. That's white guy.
Yeah,
he's
talking
about anyway.
But
it was in a commercial with him. You could still see it on YouTube where he's just dropping F-bombs over and over, him and Castle, just like, shut the fuck up, when they thought he was going to be good, and then he went out and sucked.
Yeah. Did you say British Knights? It was a British Knights
commercial? I don't know what it was. It was a ruse or something. It was something weird.
Bugle
something
Boy nobody jeans.
Buys. Maybe it was Carl Kanai, or like Cross Colors or something. I think it was Cross Colors.
On sale at Kmart.
Oh shit, that's funny. Well, why don't we listen to some music and then continue talking shit, not getting shot? So, you guys want to play something?
I'm out of songs. I only had the one.
Steve, you want to play another song?
Sure. How about a little... I haven't played Darlings in a little while. Let's play Together We Fight Alone. That's a little older track. A really good one. So you're listening to Punk Rock Foodies Radio. This is the Darlings with Together We Fight Alone.
Woo!
Right on.
Ride it up.
That was Chaos Delivery Machine with Kill, Kill, Kill on Punk Rock Foodies Radio. Fun, fun little sleepy time jaunt.
Fun for the whole family.
Yes. But, so what, you guys have any big plans for the fall other than watching football?
Not really. I mean, I'm getting married, but other than that, nothing big.
Nothing.
It's funny because what I'm gonna in all of September, I'm not gonna drink any beer because I'm trying to get in shape. Like Sheena's busting her ass. She's like going to the gym and adjusting her diet. Meanwhile, I'm just sitting here.
She's just doing side bends and sit-ups, though, right?
Yeah, she's not gonna do that, meanwhile, I'm just like, you know what? I should probably do something. So all of September, I'm not going to drink any beer, and I'm going to, you know, kind of start running a little bit. So that's going to be weird. I think last year or the year before, I did a whole month where I didn't drink beer, and I almost died. So we'll see.
Yeah,
see what happens this time.
I remember suggesting you do it in February because it's a shorter month, but...
Yeah. But I got to try and do it right before the wedding because we're getting married in October, so yeah. I'm going to try and... get in some kind of shape.
Round is a shape.
So,
yeah.
Dude, three Floyd's not going to know what's going on Mondays when you're not there, dude.
I know. Every time I go in there, it's just going to be like, where's Brian?
Yeah. No, I hear you, man. I went on that 2-week detox and I didn't drink at all and I was running every day and I lost a couple of pounds, but then it was like, man, once I went to the beach, it was time to retox and.
Retox. That's the thing, the retox.
I'm back at it, but I'm lightening it up a little bit. My folks came out and my mom wasn't drinking. She's like, "You're on the wagon too, right?" I'm like, "No." What the hell did you hear that?
What are you supposed to do on the beach? Not drink? That doesn't make any sense.
Right, exactly. It's hot. Beer's cold.
It's the beach.
There you go.
It's a waste of a good day.
Hell yeah. I know, yeah, right? Yeah. So. Listen.
Man, there's a lot of action over here at the Vicious Pig today. Let's bring your family to work day.
Yeah. We're going back to school shopping after this.
Yeah, I am so, like I said, I'm so not looking forward to going back to work. And I was just telling Rachel, like,
is it next week or this week?
The first day of school is next week, but I go back to work tomorrow. So, but I'm like, I don't even know like what's going on. Like, I haven't checked my work email all summer. I don't know what's going on. Apparently, we've got two new teachers working with me. I don't know anything about it. I'm just like, whatever. I'm going in, and just do my fucking job. That's it.
Wow. Good times.
Yeah, it's gonna be great. 180 days. That's all I need. 180 days. Unfortunately. Unfortunately, they're not.
I'm going to meet. I'm going to meet my Tristan's teacher tonight, so that'll be fun. It's gonna be. Sheena's not gonna be there, so it's gonna be me and a bunch of moms. I'm gonna be looking good. I'm gonna break some hearts.
There you go.
Yeah, I just went to go get the kids' haircuts today, and I was the only guy in there, and it was all moms and the kids.
Yeah. We took Amelia shopping today for some clothes and. Man, there are some odd-looking fucking families in the Old Navy, I tell you what. I was just thrilled that my kid is actually a normal-looking child. But she made out like a bandit.
Yeah, I saw a kid yesterday. I was at Dairy Queen. I saw a kid. He looked like Andrew Luck. I'm like, ooh, that's an ugly human. You should not look. If you look like Andrew Luck and you're not Andrew Luck, that sucks for you because he's a millionaire and you're not. So he can look like that. You can't unless you win the lottery this week. Don't look like Andrew Luck.
Especially if you're a little kid. That's even worse.
Oh, yeah. He's 5 years old. He's already got that horrible neck beard. the Andrew Luck neck beard.
Dude, it looks like he was thawed out. Like,
Andrew Luck with those ears.
Yeah,
he does. He looks like Brendan Fraser. He is Neanderthal.
Wheezing the juice.
Wheezing the juice.
Whatever happened to Pauly Shore? Is he still? He's still kicking, right?
He runs a comedy club in L.A.
Well, was it his mom's
place?
He
took over. Yeah, he took it over, so he runs it. He had a documentary a couple years ago about. How his like just kind of like a joke documentary about how his career like went down the tubes, but he's fine. He made a bunch of money. He's good. I'm not worried about him. you know?
Yeah.
So, but he has a good sense of humor about it. But he was, Pauly Shore was a big deal for a long time, if I recall correctly.
Yeah. He was in a ton of movies.
Biodome, of all fucking things.
I feel like Stephen Baldwin.
When they find the nitrous, he's like, I feel like a duck-bill platypus. I used to love that. I thought it was so funny. Back when I found stoner movies funny.
What was that? Son-in-Law. He was really good in Son-in-Law. That was a good movie.
He was in Son-in-Law. He was in the Army Now. Just going to call this the Pauly Shore episode?
This is the Pauly Shore segment. This is our Pauly Shore moment of the day. Hey, buddy.
Dude, I think every week we should review a different Pauly Shore movie. Everybody has to watch In the Army Now next week.
I'd rather do like the Ernest movies.
Oh, God. I liked Ernest Scared Stupid. The problem with either of those is you have to pretty much get them on VHS, because you're not going to get them on Netflix.
That's true. I have a VCR still. I have a VCR.
Yeah, but you got to find the tape. I don't know if the Blockbuster ain't around anymore.
That's true. I saw Ernest Goes to Camp in the theater.
Oh yeah, at the end when he parachutes in the turtles, I remember thinking that was so funny. I loved it. And then I watched it about 10 years later and I was like, this is the lamest fucking thing I've ever seen in my life. But at that age, I thought it was just the pinnacle of comedy.
That's like, exactly.
It doesn't get any better than this. Ernest Scared Stupid with the trolls and whatnot, I loved that movie.
I never saw Ernest Scared Stupid.
Oh, it's a classic. American classic. Not really.
Ernest P. Like, that's like Larry the Cable Guy is like the Ernest of this generation.
Oh, yeah, at least Jim Varney had talent. Ernest, the Cable Guy is just a fucking asshole who does a voice. Like, Jim Varney, or Ernest, like, he had a Saturday morning show where he did a bunch of impressions. It wasn't very good. But Larry the Cable Guy is just riding the coattails of, what's his name, Jeff Foxworthy. And those are some rough coattails, bro.
He does Golden Corral commercials. He's good.
That's right. Hey, he's cashing those checks.
Larry the Cable Guy is Mater. He's good, dude. He's set for life.
Yeah, that's right. He's the voice on Cars, so.
Is he? Oh, that's right.
Yeah, he's the tow truck.
Yeah. Once you get on the Disney payroll, things get real good, you know?
Must be nice.
Shit. Comes in every now and then, does a voice for a ride or something, you know?
Exactly.
For the waiting in line video, as people, you know?
Of a beloved character like that, you're getting paid.
Yeah. We got to get into that.
For $200, I did the voiceover about probably a dozen years ago. I did a voiceover for a sexual harassment video for Allstate Insurance.
Nice.
I was working there at the time. I was like 22 years old. No, it was longer than 12 years ago. It's about 22, 23. And I'm sitting there in my cubicle, and one of the bigwigs walks by and was like, I like your voice. Do you want to do a voiceover for a video, a training video? And I go, sure. Because I just wanted to get away from my desk. And he's like, we'll pay you $200 and you can go home afterwards. I'm like, okay. And I just had to, like, it's this really, I don't even know if they still use the video, but it was like a bunch of scenarios, and I'd set it up like, this is Bill. He works with Tabitha. Is it wrong that Bill says this? And what happens if he says this? It was so bad. It was terrible. And they showed it to every new hire for a decade. I don't know if they still use it, but it was terrible. It was my voice doing the whole thing.
Anybody has a copy of that video, please email post.rock.foodies@gmail.com. We need to get our hands on that.
Any Allstate employees, let's get a hold of that video. It is bad, dude. It is bad. But I'll tell you what, the voiceover is fucking on fleek.
For $200, man, they got you cheap, too. And to go home early. That was the
dude, I was 22, 23. That might as well have been like, you might as well be giving me $1 million. You give me $200 cash, and I get to go home about 4 hours early? Oh, my God. I felt like I hit the lottery.
Hell yeah.
That was great.
I find $10 in an old coat. I'm like, yeah, man. Bitch.
And it was a Friday. Oh, man. I thought I was king shit. for 20 minutes worth of work.
That's awesome. And you didn't even have to write the script. All you had to do was read it.
Yeah, oh, man. Beautiful. It was terrible. Just absolutely terrible shit. I'm reading this like, what kind of idiot writes this? You know what I mean? It was like a haiku written by a 90-year-old. It was just terrible shit. It was just bad.
That's funny. Fuck. Do you guys know we got the guy from Diesel Boy is calling us.
Really?
Is
that his name?
Him.
The guy?
The guy from Diesel Boy, yeah. Well, with the guitar player, Justin Wirth.
Mr. Boy is going to call us?
Yeah. He can be called Diesel.
Dr. Diesel?
Yeah.
I wonder if he knows Shaq.
That'll be fun to talk to him.
Get some actual talent on the show? Yeah, Diesel Boy's the shit.
Yeah, I love Diesel Boy.
Remind me, they did that song Titty Twister, right?
Yeah.
I love that song. Dude, that was like one of my first songs that I ever really got into. It was on the original Fat Records compilation.
It was on the Survival of the Fattest, yeah.
Yeah, dude, my pants are falling down, the room is spinning around.
That was a great compilation.
Yes, the original one. I mean, nothing has touched it since, in my opinion.
Well, no, actually, Survival of the Fattest was the second one. Fat Music for Fat People was the first one that came out.
Was that the first one?
And that was really good, and then they did just as well with the second one, but then, yeah, they've started kind of, I don't know. I don't like the compilations anymore.
Live Fat, Die Young, Survival of the Fattest.
Life in the Fat Lane.
Life in the Fat Lane, that's what it was, yeah.
But they're just, you know, I think they used to put out unreleased stuff, or things that were coming out on albums, and like now it's like...
B-sides.
Yeah, well, now it's stuff that's already been out, and it's nothing, like, new. You know,
well,
a couple new songs, but...
In the mid to late 90s and even early 2000s, like, compilations were the thing. They were the way to go.
Yeah.
Like, that's how you learned about shit. That was,
the Warped Tour
before,
one was amazing.
Yeah.
Oh, the Warped Tour one? I mean, this is before Spotify and Pandora and all these ways that you can learn about new bands by just, like, clicking it on. Back then, you got a compilation CD or, like, the Epitaph... The Epitaph ones, those were. That's how I learned about a lot of bands.
I got a couple Lookout ones. That's absolutely right.
And those comps used to be stacked, like 25 songs. You know, like it was a lot of shit. You know, so it was always good.
If you didn't get them for like free, like they had handing them out to you as you left the show.
Yeah.
You know, they were like $3, $5, you know, at the National Record Mart, you know.
I got, what was it, Short Music for Short People? I got it for $5. And that's considered one of the classics of all time. It's got all the bands on there.
Yeah, and you're right. I mean, I think I've got one that's got like 30 songs on it, you know. I mean, it's just song after song, you know.
Yeah, they didn't fuck around.
But, yeah.
Hey, get these kids some shots.
Yeah, shots around!
Doctor, bring us some, children's NyQuil over here, nighttime formula. Might be about nap time.
So, well, you guys have anything else you want to talk about? I mean, we kind of didn't really talk about anything, so.
We talked about Pauly Shore.
So different from every... We should literally call this the Pauly Shore episode.
Hey buddy.
Hashtag the weasel.
The weasel.
Weasing the juice.
Well, here's the thing. We don't talk about anything important on regular episodes where we actually have topics, so it's all right.
Yeah.
It's
why would this be any different?
Yeah. Right?
why mess with a good thing?
Yeah. All right. Well, let's why don't we head off with a song and get Justin on the phone. And find out about Diesel Boy and other projects that he's working on.
I got a little dance number.
Go for it.
A band that we have not played on here before, but we have interviewed one of the members, Dan Palmer. This is one of his side projects called Austrian Death Machine with a song called Get to the Chopper on Punk Rock Foodies Radio.
Do it now! Kidding!
Have you guys heard that song?
Now our escape begins! This is the chopper! It's the only way out of here! Don't let them stop you! Don't let them hold! Our chance. We all must go. Dead
chopper! Get to the chopper! Get to the chopper! Get to the chopper! Suck like gambling, won't lock you out. It's not as good on me if I can't fall it down. I would have another drink, except it might be poisoned by my mind if I can't fall it down. I don't know what you've been drinking, but former number one for me. My pants are falling down. The room is spinning around. My stomach is making funny sounds. I'm falling down. Falling down. Fuck you, I hate shoes, all she said. As she slapped my face and spit beer on me, and my pants falling down. She said you're a no good, unducted a punk rocker with a bad haircut, and your pants falling down. I don't know what you've been smoking, but back another bottle. The room is spinning around and around. My stomach is making funny sounds. I'm falling down. I'm falling down. I'm falling down. My pants fall down the room and spin around and round. My stomach really feels like shaking all its making funny sounds. I'm falling down. I'm falling down.
And that was Titty Twister by Diesel Boy. And on the phone with us now is the guitarist for Diesel Boy, Mr. Justin Wirth. Justin, how you doing?
I'm doing awesome, Xander. Thanks for asking. How are you?
I'm good. So, I know that you're not just the guitarist for Diesel Boy. You're in a couple of other bands. But Diesel Boy was the oldest one. Tell us a little bit about how Diesel Boy started and how you guys all got together.
Well, back in the early 90s, I was going to Sonoma State University, and I had actually just started playing guitar, when I moved up here from Southern California. A lot of people, play guitar when the time that they're young, and I was a real late starter, but I spent a lot of time in my dorm room practicing the first couple years. I don't think I barely ever went to class. I'm pretty surprised that I even graduated. But I taught myself how to play guitar and played in some, my first couple bands. And during that time, Dave from Diesel Boy had started Diesel Boy with some original members. And we played shows together. The band that I was in at that time was named Scapegoat. And as a turn of events would have it, Scapegoat broke up. Our singer left to do other stuff, and Dave was having issues with his rhythm section. At that point, Diesel Boy was a three-piece, so it was just Dave and then a bass player and a drummer. And so we kind of both bands disintegrated at the same time, so to speak, and Dave was also at Sonoma State, as was Mike, our original drummer, and Mike and Dave hooked up, and because we knew each other from playing shows together. And long story short, Mike and our bass player Greg, who had moved out from Austin, Texas, a few years prior, hooked up, and Dave was thinking, hey, I got my three piece back together, but he knew of me, and Mike was really pushing for a two guitar setup. So it was shortly after those guys joined the band that Dave approached me and asked me to be a Diesel Boy, and that was about a month after I finished Sonoma State. We all finished our schoolwork, and and then Diesel Boy just kind of, Diesel Boy as you know it, at least the first two records were with Mike playing drums, started that way.
And the first album was Cock Rock that came out in 96, and you guys were touring like crazy. I think I read somewhere that you guys toured almost every state. You were playing like 40 of the 50 states or something.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, we, so Dave, you know, Dave was a communications major, and he needed to fulfill some internship credits, and so what happened is he got an internship at, Fat Records, and he was kind of sly about it. He didn't, you know, didn't say, hey guys, I'm in a band. Like the first day he was in there, he kind of just sort of, you know, got in there, was a good worker, and then just kind of let it slip to, you know, some guys in the warehouse, in the back of the house, and you know, slowly but surely, you know, word got to Fat Mike that he was in a band, and at that same time, the guys from Bracket, who also were from Sonoma County and were doing a lot of stuff on Fat Records at that point, were friends of ours, and so in conjunction with, you know, what he'd heard from the warehouse guys, and from Bracket, Mike decided to give us a listen, and he liked it, and said he wanted to put out a record. So he started Honest Don's used recordings, and we were like the flagship band for that. And that Mike waved his magic wand, and you know, talked to the guys from Strung Out and said, "Hey, I want you to take these guys on tour with you on your next tour." So our first tour ever was in a bus. It was 9 weeks, the United States and Canada. So that was, we played in, you know, most of the states that first tour, and we went all the way, you know, played in every province in Canada, and you know, we continued to do that. I think we did 5 full Canadian tours over our over our 4 record period. 5 full United States tours, and then various sort of West Coast smaller jaunts. I know we did 2 weeks with the Vandals for their Christmas album. That was a Pacific Northwest and just West Coast tour. And then we went to Europe 3 times. I think once on our own, or twice on our own, and once with Strung Out. And we also did Australia once.
So opening for Strung Out, you guys probably play in some pretty decent sized venues back then.
Absolutely. You know, we really enjoyed Eastern Canada was at that time, and I think still it was just really a hotbed for punk rock. You know, we had, I remember playing Three Rivers, Trois-Rivières, and that was a huge show. You know, we were playing at the biggest shows were probably, you know, 2,000 people. So I mean, that was you know, fantastic for us.
So all this touring in all these different cities all over, well, the world, pretty much, what is one of the cities that you wish you could go back to just specifically for the food?
Specifically for the food. You know, I would have to say Paris Brands. You know, it's definitely a place where, you know, the equivalent of what we have, and we have here in the States, we'll have like a strip mall, you know, restaurants, right? Stuff that's like local, you don't hear about, but, you know, they're kind of, another way to say would be like a hole-in-the-wall place. Right. And I feel like in Paris, France, that their equivalent of that, although they don't have, you know, strip malls per se, the equivalent of the neighborhood bistro there, I feel like the quality of food is you know, is outstanding for what you pay. It's just it's a great value, and you know, and they really you know, they I feel like they just care about what they're putting out, and I noticed that. And while I was touring, I was journaling a lot, and I made a list of 5 cities that I, you know, would live in for a year if I had the opportunity. And you know, and Paris was on that list. And certainly it was, you know, it was on that list because of its beauty, architecture, and of course food. So,
What about just in the United States alone? I mean, like you said, you guys have been to every state almost. So, what about just in the States?
Right. As far as food cities in the United States, Chicago. I definitely enjoyed Chicago, and then I sort of learned to during that period I never really liked spicy food, but during that period I started getting more interested in spicy food. So I would say the Southwest, Austin had a few great meals in Austin. So I would say definitely those two, and you can't really beat New Orleans for unhealthy fried stuff. So
yeah,
tasty though.
So you in the restaurant industry, so to speak.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about your ventures there.
Well, the restaurant industry, really parallels my punk rock career. First of all, as just someone that was in a band that was successful, but like we weren't making $1 million. I still had to have a job when I came home. I mean, there was we'd be on the road for a month or two, but you have to take some time off. And if we were lucky, we would set it up so we'd be home for a month and then go back out. But sometimes, there were periods where we were writing for a new record, and we'd have some extended time at home. And the restaurant industry was a great way for me to supplement my income. And being a food lover and being good with people, being in the service industry was perfect for me, because I could leave and then come back and wait tables for several months while we were working on a record, or just taking some time off. Living in Sonoma County, which is adjacent to Napa County, there's a lot of outstanding food to be had, a lot of great restaurants. Just the fact that where we sit geographically, there's tons of farms around here, and just a lot of great local produce, and even meats and stuff like that. So I did that for I waited tables for a while, and towards the end, I finally started to get the idea that, hey, maybe I can do this myself. Towards the end of when Diesel Boy was really hitting it hard, and once our final record was out and we kind of slowed down in touring, I got together with my brother-in-law, and we decided to open a French bistro. He's in fact he met my sister in Paris, and I actually went back after Diesel Boy stopped being super active and lived in Paris for almost 2 years. So we all migrated back to Santa Rosa, and we found that there was no place here that we wanted to go that reminded us of Paris. So he and I put a lot of time and money into creating something that was a little piece of Paris, and it was it was very well received. We had a raw bar with oysters on a half shell. Initially our menu was had all the names of the dishes were in French, which we realized was a little ahead of its time for our small country town, and we eventually had to change that just to not be so off-putting. We thought it kind of scared people away, but we had a great patio, lots of traditional French dishes. So that's kind of what was up with that.
So, as I said at the beginning of the interview, you're not just the guitar player for Diesel Boy. There's a couple other projects you've been working on. You want to tell us about those?
Absolutely. So I got together with a local guy, actually a Bay Area guy. His name is Sam McBride, and he's also known as Sammy Town. And he is the singer, the frontman for a band called Fang, which is a psychedelic punk rock band that's I guess is what I'm trying to say. And he wanted to do something a little more current, a little, you know, a little different. And so we started the Disciples, and we put out a record, which is on Malt Soda Records. It's called Redemption, and yeah, it's a great mix of rock and roll and punk rock. So that is really enjoyed being a part of. He and Bang are recently touring, and as soon as they get back, we are considering doing a new record. I also played in Bang for a while. I'm actually on the most recent recording, so you know, been pretty involved with stuff with him. Most recently, I am involved in a project called Black Poison Viper. And despite the name, it is not a metal band. It's like an 80s, think like a 80s movies soundtrack almost. Kind of like, you know, it's a lot of keyboard, and but there's definitely some rock elements, and it's a lot of fun. I have a lot of latitude to play guitar solos, you know, whereas, you know, with Diesel Boy, for example, I have like what I call lead break, where it goes by, you know, really fast. In Black Poison Viper, I get to noodle a little bit more, and you know, and improv, and that's the kind of stuff that I really enjoy. So so the Disciples, Fang, and Black Poison Viper are all projects that I've been involved in or I'm working on currently. So yeah.
And there was rumors that there's a Diesel Boy album kind of in the works. Is that true, or?
Well, we actually demoed and recorded it a couple years ago, and we presented it to Fat Mike, and he said, "Hey guys, I like this, but not all of it. Let's keep working on it, and you know, and we'll eventually put something out." And since that happened, you know, there's been some irreconcilable differences, I will say, within the band, and it looks like that is no longer on the table, at least for the time being. I think you know, our drummer, our current drummer Jeff Arcuri, has officially stepped down, and you know, Greg as well as myself are working on other projects, and Dave has a project called the Dirty Outs, which he is focusing on right now. So it would appear that Diesel Boy at this point is completely finished, and will probably not put out that final record, which is a little disappointing to I think to everybody. But as I said again, you know, it's difficult to get four individuals to constantly agree on stuff is not always easy. I wish we could figure it out, but at this point, as I said, it's not looking good. So we're sorry about that, and I think we need to address our fans, you know, publicly at some point about that. But I feel like, you know, Jeff posted on our Facebook page in the last couple of months that you know, he was no longer done, and I think that was sort of, you know, the record not coming out is pretty much implied by, you know, by that. But we'll see.
Well, yeah, I mean, the tracks are out there, so maybe somebody will want to release it just as a, like, almost like a remember these guys. This is what they did, you know.
That's what we want. That's what, you know, some of us wanted to do that. And there was a couple members that were not happy with the quality and didn't want to have that be a final representation of the band. And that was one of the areas that we sort of banged heads. So, you know, that is where that lies. You can hear some of the songs that we're going to be on it, because Dave has kind of enveloped those into the fold of the Dirty Out. So those were songs that we worked on, and you know, would have been Diesel Boy songs, but you can still hear them in that venue. So,
real quick, what's one of your favorite things to cook when you're at home?
One of my favorite things to cook, you know, I have a couple things in my repertoire that I can throw down, I love making pasta carbonara. I think it is it's a very forgiving dish. It's kind of a thing that you can have, three eggs or four. If you have four, if you have three, it's still gonna turn out good. I love bacon, egg, and cheese, and why not? It's not only for breakfast, right? Yeah. So that's a go-to for me. I love pasta. I also garden, so this time of year I'm looking at my tomatoes and my basil plants, and to do a real simple garlic and oil tomato and basil sauce, which I usually freeze in separate containers so I can pull them out in the winter time when tomatoes aren't as well, when my garden tomatoes are not no longer existent, and get a little taste of summertime in the winter. I really enjoy doing that. And of course, barbecue. I mean, I'm a pretty avid barbecuer, so I've been doing that a lot this summer too. I love the steak and burgers and just sausages, basic stuff. Anything with fire is fun for me.
Get
that primal instinct going.
I do that same thing with like making tomato sauce and then freezing it, but I just, for the first time in my life, this past, actually 2 days ago, I canned. I canned pickles and stuff, and I'll tell you what, it's a process, but I know it's worth it, because my mom's always canned my entire life, so you might want to look
at it. Yeah, I love that kind of stuff.
Yeah. All right, so anything else that you want to tell us about that's going on, or...
No, man. I mean, that's good. I would love for the listeners to check out, our Black Poison Viper Facebook page and the Disciples as well. Look for, a new record from the Disciples and Black Poison Viper is going to be going into the studio. I've been doing a lot of recording of just on my phone, video recording of our process. If you're interested to see how, songs evolve, I usually wait until they're, pretty darn decent before I even will post them, but it's kind of a, it's a very raw look at, five guys playing in a rehearsal space, and, with technology these days, phone technology these days, it's pretty surprising how good the sound quality is, and, so I would encourage everyone to check that out. And yeah, man, that's about it. I just wanted to thank you for giving me a call and giving me an opportunity to share my story of food and music. I love what you're doing, and I look forward to following you and supporting your unique view on two things that I love.
Well, it was an honor to be able to talk to you. Diesel Boy is one of a big influential band in my in the early 90s for me, so thank you. And
you're welcome, man.
We will be leaving here with some Diesel Boy. This is off of Sofa King Cole. This is She's My Queen on Punk Rock Foodies Radio.
Your knee. I'm the Jordan Maggio. She is my queen.
All right, I'd like to thank Steve Bryan and Skate Rat. I'd like to thank Justin Wirth. Check out his bands, Black Poison Viper and The Disciples. I'd like to also thank the people here at the Vicious Pig Saloon. They always treat us well. Check out Burning Rose Studios for all your video and graphic needs. Check out Betty Gear and come on over to Punk Rock Foodies. 4,600 members and growing. Very simple. Make food. Post a pic. Bone ape tit, everyone.
You're so welcome, Xander. I hope you have an awesome day, dude.